Hello everyone, and welcome to Differential Equations, section 3.7, Electrical Circuits. Quick disclaimer before we begin, this chapter will be based solely from a math perspective rather than a physics perspective. As such, I will assume no prior physics experience, and I won't go in depth on any of the circuit elements. I'm sure many of you are familiar with circuit diagrams. If you've taken AP Physics 1, you probably see something like this. In today's lesson, however, we'll be going over something slightly different, called the RLC circuit. Let's move on to a bit of basic terminology. The R here is a resistor, the L is an inductor, and finally, the C is a capacitor. Putting all of these together, we get the name RLC circuit. So now I'll go over the basic equations that have to do with this type of circuit. The main one that we'll be using in this chapter is as follows. L times di dt plus R times I plus 1 over C times Q is equal to E of t. Now let's go over each of the individual circuit elements. This first part, L times di dt, which is the inductance times the derivative of current with respect to time. This represents the voltage drop of the inductor. The second part, R times I, represents the voltage drop of the resistor, which is the resistance times the current. Finally, for the capacitor, we have 1 over C times Q, which is 1 over the capacitance times the charge. E of t is the sum of all three of these terms, and it represents the total voltage drop. Now let's manipulate this equation a bit to better fit a differential equation. I, which is the current, is by definition the derivative of charge with respect to time. In this case, we can substitute in I equals to dq dt into our equation. This gives us L times the second derivative of q plus R times the first derivative of q plus 1 over C times q is equal to E of t. We can also express everything in terms of I as an alternate form of the equation, and this would give us L times the derivative of I plus R times I plus 1 over C times Q is equal to E of t. And to make everything in terms of I, what we can do is take the derivative on both sides. So that will give us L times the second derivative of I plus R times the first derivative of I plus 1 over C I is equal to E prime of t. This is the main circuit equation that I'll be using for the rest of this chapter, and it would be a good idea to write it down. Next, I'll be talking about something called the mechanical-electrical analogy, which relates a lot of what we just looked at about circuits to what we learned earlier about mechanical systems. Now, let's take a look at our equation that we just got, and then let's compare it to the equation that we had in the previous section. When they're side by side, we can notice that a lot of it's very similar with the exception of the 1 over C and the K. Let's take a closer look at both of these equations. On the mechanical side, you have mass, damping constant, spring constant, position, and force. On the electrical side, you have inductance, resistance, reciprocal capacitance, current, and the derivative of E. Now let's find what E of t is to finish our equation. In the case of alternating current, which is current that alternates rapidly between two values, we can express E of t as E naught times sine of omega t. Since our equation has E prime of t, we can take the derivative on both sides of this equation, which gives us E prime of t is equal to omega times E naught times cosine of omega t. Let's remember the chain rule. Now we can substitute this into our equation. So this gives us L times I double prime plus R times I prime plus 1 over C I is equal to omega times E naught cosine of omega t. Now that we have all the pieces of the equation, we can solve for I, the current. The current I is actually composed of two currents, the transient current and the steady periodic current. As we learned in the last chapter, the transient solution is the same as the complementary solution, and the steady periodic solution is the same as the particular solution. The transient current is pretty easy to calculate, as all you have to do is plug it into one of those forms for the complementary solution, so we'll focus on the steady periodic solution here. Recall that from the last section, we obtained a formula for the steady periodic current in our mechanical system. In that video, we wrote it as C times cosine omega t minus alpha, and in this case, all we're doing is just substituting in C and finding the entire expression. The formula for the steady periodic current for an electrical system is remarkably similar. I've also put the mechanical-electrical analogy in the top right corner so you can see where all the similarities are. I'm not going to go over the derivation process since it's virtually identical to the one in the last video, so if you want to see how that works, just look at my 3.6 video. However, it's important to pay attention to the differences in these equations, especially in how it is 1 over capacitance instead of capacitance. Don't worry about writing these down, as we will be deriving a simpler form in the rest of this video. Lastly, I'll be talking about impedance, reactance, and time lag. So remember how in the last section we had a really nice final form for the steady periodic solution, and it was written as C times the cosine of omega t minus alpha. In that expression, we had cosine because the right side of the equation was f naught cosine of omega t, and that had a cosine. But in this case, since our right side actually has a sine, we want to convert this into a form that has sine in it. So firstly, we have the equation as we derived earlier. The denominator of this equation has a special name called the impedance. What it means isn't super important for this section, but essentially it's just the resistance of an AC circuit. We'll notate that as Z. The second squared part under the square root also has a special name called the reactance, and we denote that as S. When we put all three of these together, we have a Pythagorean-like relationship, and we can represent it with a right triangle as shown on the left. As you can see, the legs of the triangle are R and negative S, the hypotenuse is Z, and the angle is alpha. To convert our expression to a sine form, we can first plug in Z for the denominator, and then expand the cosine term. And now we can substitute in negative S over Z for cosine of alpha, and R over Z for sine of alpha. Our expression now fits the sine difference identity, so we can rewrite it as the steady periodic current is equal to E naught over Z times the sine of omega t minus what we call the delay angle. This is also pictured on the left-hand side. Notice how since R and S are flipped, alpha and the delay angle are always going to be off by pi over 2. Using the same triangle, we can now solve for what the delay angle is, which is going to be the arctangent of S over R, which is the arctangent of LC omega squared minus 1 over omega RC. And now we finally have the ideal form for the steady periodic solution. Generally, in homework problems, we would always want to put our solution in this form. We have one more definition to go over, and it's called the time lag, and it's just defined as the delay angle over omega. As shown in this image, all it does is represent the phase shift between the voltage and the steady periodic solution. That's it for this section. If you have any questions, feel free to contact me, and have a great day.